Pues en nombre de Leap Ventures Boutique y Our Crowd, sean muy bienvenidos al webinar Innovation is the Future. La innovación es el futuro. Hemos visto transformaciones en estos últimos meses sin precedente. Y sin duda, hoy queda más claro que nunca que la innovación y la tecnología serán determinantes en nuestro futuro cercano. Por ello, el nombre de este webinar.
Aquí, algunos datos muy sorprendentes del impacto de la tecnología en nuestra vida cotidiana. Esta es una gráfica de lo que sucede en un minuto en Internet en el 2020. Se descargan más de 26.000 aplicaciones, se ven más de 97.200 horas de contenido en Netflix, se toman más de 12.500 viajes en Uber, se compran más de $283.000 en Amazon. Todo esto en tan solo 60 segundos, aproximadamente el mismo tiempo que tomé en presentar esta diapositiva.
Pero además es importante decir que la innovación y la tecnología son fuente de progreso. Hoy vivimos mejor como humanidad gracias a la innovación. Un ejemplo muy claro son las soluciones médicas, pero así sucede en muchos otros ámbitos. Si bien el mundo es innatamente bueno, sobra espacio para que podamos mejorarlo. Y esto refiere a cualquier actividad que serene al mundo, acercándolo al estado armonioso para el que fue creado.
En LEAP tenemos el objetivo de acercar a México y Latinoamérica al mundo de innovación. Si bien hay proyectos muy valiosos en la región, todavía hay muchísimo por hacerse para competir con algunas otras geografías. Los queremos invitar a unirse a este gran proyecto que es LEAP Ventures Boutique, en el que estamos construyendo puentes y conectando de manera bidireccional a Latinoamérica con algunos de los ecosistemas de innovación más importantes del mundo, como lo es Israel.
LEAP, por sus siglas, LeapFrog Innovation Powerhouse, se define como una boutique de innovación que busca agregar y generar valor para sus stakeholders, al proveer servicios especializados y acceso a startups multiregionales de tecnología, al mismo tiempo que acelera el leapfrogging, concepto que inspiró su marca, y que refiere al avance constante a pasos exponenciales que permite a las empresas adentrarse en la revolución tecnológica.
LEAP hoy es una realidad. Es un proyecto consolidado por un grupo de empresas y proyectos. A la fecha, nuestro portafolio cuenta con 3 startups invertidas que han tenido muy buen desempeño, aún en estos tiempos de pandemia.
Pero lo más importante de todo son las personas detrás de las startups. Y queremos que hoy escuchen directamente de ellos sobre sus empresas y el nivel de transformación que está impulsando cada uno de ellos en diferentes industrias. Contaremos con la presencia de Gadi Mazor, director de operaciones y gerente general en Israel de BioCatch, y Gal Reichelgaus, cofundador y CEO de Cartica, Asaf Karmi, CEO de Consumer Physics, Felipe Ayerbe y Eduardo Chobal, cofundadores de Demetria, y a John Medved, fundador y CEO, y Alan Weisleder, socio y vicepresidente de Relación con Inversionistas, ambos de Our Crowd.
Esperamos que, antes que nada, disfruten mucho este webinar, que abra sus ojos, mentes y corazones, y que nos inspire para impactar positivamente nuestro entorno. Agradecemos mucho a todas y todos ustedes por su participación, al embajador de Israel en México, Zvi Tal, y todo el personal de la embajada, a Our Crowd y John Medved, y a los diversos ponentes que veremos a continuación.
Pues sin más, los dejamos con Alan Weisleder, partner y vicepresidente de Relación con Inversionistas, y John Medved, fundador y CEO de Our Crowd, nuestro socio y cómplice en este gran proyecto. Gracias, John. Gracias, Alan. And now we switch to English.
Perdón, ya me hice un lío. Muchas gracias, Nathan, y muchas gracias, Mario. Vamos a empezar con... en español todavía, hasta que le pase el micrófono a John. Es un placer estar aquí con ustedes. Me uno a ustedes desde Israel. Hablo español porque soy originalmente de Costa Rica, pero he vivido toda mi vida adulta entre Israel y Silicon Valley. Así que es un placer estar con ustedes. Empezamos pues tocando brevemente en el por qué perdón, en el por qué invertir en Venture Capital. Y la verdad que es increíble ver esta lámina con y entender y tener la sensación de la velocidad y la forma en la que ha acelerado el cambio y la penetración de las tecnologías a nivel mundial. O sea, si vemos, le tomó a la electricidad 45 años penetrar el 80% de las casas en Estados Unidos. Le tomó a las computadoras 25 años en penetrar el 80% de las casas. Le tomó a los teléfonos celulares, a los smartphones, menos de 15 años en hacer lo mismo. O sea, el nivel de aceleración de la penetración de la tecnología sigue aumentando cada vez más y más. Y esto se ve claramente reflejado en el tiempo promedio en el que pertenecen compañías al índice S&P 500 de compañías en la bolsa americana. En los años 50 del siglo pasado, el promedio que vivía una compañía como parte del índice S&P 500 eran 60 años. En 1980 fueron 30 años y en el 2012 fueron tan solo 20 años. Credit Suisse proyecta que de aquí al 2027, al 2027, la vida promedio de una compañía en el índice S&P 500 se va a ver reducida a tan solo 12 años. COVID ha sido otro catalizador de cambio y está causando, pues, nuevamente la aceleración de la transformación digital. Y lo dijo claramente Satya Nadella, el CEO de Microsoft, que dijo: hemos visto 2 años de transformación digital en tan solo 2 meses. Entre las transformaciones, todos estamos trabajando de casa y hoy presentando en este webinar, tanto John como yo, y creo que vi a Mario y a Nathan también en casa, y así está Bill Gates también. La mayoría de nosotros estamos reportando que la productividad nuestra en el trabajo desde casa es igual o mayor que la productividad en la oficina. El CEO de Morgan Stanley dijo recientemente: el futuro es mucho menos oficinas, mucho menos real estate. Hemos demostrado que podemos llevar la labor a cabo sin tener los edificios tan caros y tan grandes que tenemos en las ciudades más grandes de los Estados Unidos. Y lo que es distinto, o sea, en todas las recesiones en los últimos años, en la de 1991, la del 2000 o la del 2008, en cada una de esas recesiones ha habido una pérdida muy grande de empleos que no se han vuelto a crear después de la recesión. Y lo que pasa es que la automatización, en cada una de estas recesiones, las compañías invierten más y más en automatización como una forma de convertirse en más eficientes y poder lidiar con la recesión. Ahora, si nos fijamos en la recesión del 2008-2009, la mayoría de los puestos de trabajo que se perdieron, 88% de los puestos son puestos de paga baja, puestos que son relativamente fáciles de automatizar, de reemplazar con tecnología. Lo que es distinto en esta recesión, en esta crisis por la que estamos pasando hoy en día, es que la inteligencia artificial ha llegado a un nivel de maduración que no existía en el 2008, ¿ok? El mundo está conectado, el cloud se ha hecho, ha penetrado todas las áreas de nuestra vida. El big data se ha convertido en algo muy, muy, muy popular, muy, que todas las compañías tienen acceso, y los procesadores y los algoritmos para AI están desarrollados a un nivel completamente distinto de lo que eran hace 10 o 12 años. Y esto lo que significa es que las compañías que tienen acceso, las compañías de tecnología que pueden utilizar todos estos avances, pues están teniendo un auge súper importante que lo vemos reflejado en las valoraciones de las compañías y en el hecho de que Amazon está captando 100,000 empleados adicionales. Facebook ha visto una explosión en las llamadas de video por WhatsApp. Microsoft está reportando que todas las herramientas de colaboración se están vendiendo. O sea, ha tenido una demanda muchísimo superior a lo que tenía antes de COVID. La pregunta es, o sea, sin lugar a duda hay oportunidades de inversión en el sector tecnológico y es el sector en el que mucha gente está queriendo invertir. Pero el asunto es cómo accesar las inversiones en el sector tecnológico cuando estas aún son privadas. Porque lo que vemos en esta lámina es que en los años 80 o 90 se podía hacer un retorno muy, muy importante invirtiendo en compañías de tecnología cuando ya estas eran públicas. Esa es la barra verde. Pero en los últimos 10 años, la barra verde es casi invisible. La posibilidad de hacer dinero invirtiendo en compañías de tecnología cuando estas ya son públicas es extremadamente limitada. Y eso es lo que está realmente envigorando la inversión en venture capital, que a nivel mundial continúa creciendo casi en forma continua todos los años. Y eso es también lo que le ha causado a fondos de inversión, fondos institucionales como Yale, el de la Universidad de Yale, de en forma muy continua ir aumentando la cantidad de dinero del fondo que ellos invierten en venture capital. De 13.7% en el 2014 a 19% en el 2018 y casi 22% este año. Jay Clayton, el chairman del SEC americano, ha visto este trend y habla muy abiertamente de la necesidad que existe en el mercado de crear avenidas, caminos para que los inversionistas, para que no solo Yale Endowment, el fondo de inversión de la Universidad de Yale, o inversionistas institucionales sean los que puedan accesar inversiones tecnológicas de calidad en los mercados privados. Y eso es exactamente lo que hacemos en ArcCrowd, empezando en Israel, pero hoy en día ya en todo el mundo. Y con eso quiero invitar a mi socio, al CEO y founder de ArcCrowd, John Medved, uno de los pilares del ecosistema israelí, a hablar un poquito sobre el ecosistema tecnológico de Israel. John.
Gracias, Alan, y bienvenidos a todos. Yo siento que no puedo hablar español más bueno para discutir negocios y inversiones, y entonces vamos a hablar en inglés. I hope that if I visit Lip and you more frequently, my Spanish will improve so that I will feel comfortable in making this presentation in Spanish in the next time. I get the pleasure of talking about the Israeli system and why Israel has really taken a leadership position in innovation worldwide, what we're doing at ArcCrowd about that, and in particular, how we're doing during the current pandemic. Now, it used to be that when I gave presentations like this many years ago, I would have to show a slide from a Zionist organization or the Israeli embassy. Now the people at Davos do my work for me. Turns out that they've declared Israel the most innovative country in the world. Number one in entrepreneurial culture, number one in attitudes towards entrepreneurial risk or for companies embracing disruptive ideas. Israel today is indeed the world's startup nation. And when you look at what has been invested in Israel, across the board over the last decade, it's really quite remarkable. We've gone from about $2 billion to this year, there will be about $10 billion. And I can say that with some degree of confidence, given the fact that the first half of the year was over $5 billion, and the last 2 months have each been about $700 million. So we're going to hit the $10 billion range. To give you an idea of how big that is relative to LATAM, the entire Latin American continent is investing about half of that amount this year. So Israel is literally twice as much investment dollars in startups as LATAM, which is pretty remarkable given the disparity in population size. Now, the other good thing is that we've had another record year last year in exits. It's obviously not as important how much we invest, but how much we take back. And this continues to be quite extraordinary. The most important thing is that the exits are getting much larger. Israel is now producing multi-billion dollar companies. The biggest so far was Mobileye, which was acquired by Intel for $15 billion. But now both Checkpoint and Wix, who are both public companies, are reaching $20 billion kind of valuations. The real question is going to be, will Israel produce a $100 billion or $500 billion company? And my bet, by the way, is we will get to that magic $100 billion number within the next several years. Just to remind you, by the way, Zoom today is now at, well, I haven't checked it this morning, but over the last couple of days, it hit over $100 billion and actually passed IBM in its value. So if Zoom can do it, we can do it in Israel for sure. When you look at our ecosystem, it consists of thousands and thousands of entrepreneurs, many angel investments, investors, lots of venture capital funds, incubators galore, the Israel's army, which produces tremendous technology, as well as driving the culture of entrepreneurship, and lots of multinationals who have set up a shop in Israel, train our executives, and then buy in these M&A transactions, the startups. Now, all of this was great until all of a sudden we signed a deal with our new friends over in the Gulf in the UAE. And this is going to unlock billions of dollars of new investment and tremendous sales opportunities, not just into the UAE, but into the whole region. So this is a game changer, which we're very, very active and excited about. Now, let's talk a little bit about our crowd. Our crowd today is managing close to $1.5 billion of funds. We have over 50,000 investors coming from almost every country of the world. We have over 40 exits, and you have the choice of investing either in an individual company or in funds, which we now offer 22 funds to our investors, and we have over 200 portfolio companies. Here's what our portfolio looks like. It's getting hard to put this all on one slide and to make it big enough so you can see it. But what you can see is that it's highly diversified. We have everything from mobility to cannabis, from e-commerce to food tech, from enterprise software to optics and energy, and of course, cybersecurity and fintech. We also run 5 incubators, 4 in Israel, which are government supported, with the government providing as much as 85% of the first $1 million of investment, and our first overseas incubator in New Zealand. We hope that we'll be operating incubators all over the world to do this kind of early stage venture creation. Now, if you look at our investments, we have actually become quite an interesting global player. When we started, we invested almost exclusively in Israel. But today, our crowd is very proud that we're a global platform investing all over the world from our Jerusalem headquarters, and that literally 46% of our investments last year were made outside of Israel, which we think is a great thing. In addition, we are also investing according to each stage of a company's existence. We do seed investments all the way to pre-IPO, as long as the companies are private. We're not now currently investing in public companies. That's not our mandate. And if you look at how many of our companies are responding and taking leadership roles in the COVID-19 crisis, it's really quite remarkable. You'll hear from a couple of our companies later, and you'll get a chance to see how they're doing. But both medical companies and non-medical companies are addressing the new normal and are actually taking real advantage of this crisis, are on the front lines. Just today, by the way, one of our companies, MeMed, you see here, announced a deal for their new development where they basically can tell you instantaneously whether you have a virus or a bacterial infection. Big deal announced today. And all of these companies are doing great things, and you'll hear more about them later today in the webinar. We actually have really grown our portfolio in terms of its maturity. So you see that today we're reaching 60 companies already that are over $100 million in value, which means that we have the ability of investing in later stage as well as these early stage companies. And again, this is a little out of date. We're already at 40 exits, and our companies are being sold to the biggest companies in the world, whether it's Samsung or Canon, to Oracle, Intel, Snapchat, Microsoft, and our companies are doing great in their IPOs. Last year, we were very fortunate that Beyond Meat was our company where we invested before it went public, and it was the best performing IPO, not just of last year, but of the decade. And in terms of IPOs this year, Lemonade went public and actually had the best debut of any company this year so far. So what kind of sectors do we invest in? It turns out that we're obviously a fintech company ourselves, and we like fintech. So we've invested in Lemonade, which is a company doing automated insurance. We just mentioned that they went public, and DailyPay, who allow low-paid employees to get access to their money every day. Both of these were lit investments, and BioCatch, which you will hear from shortly. Okay, Kenna in cybersecurity, a great threat detection platform. Cyber MDX to keep all of our medical devices secure so that a hacker won't send you a message that you have 30 minutes to live until he turns off your infusion pump or your pacemaker. And ThetaRay doing great AML and KYC using AI. In mobility, we have leading companies like Cartica, who you will hear today is a lit portfolio company, or Innoviz, who is going to be powering all of the BMW Series 3 in this next year, or Phantom Auto, who is allowing humans to control around the world companies that are doing delivery bots or automated forklifts. Very, very important company, not just for autonomous driving, but for logistics. In the area of artificial intelligence, Israel is one of the world leaders, and we have Israel's largest portfolio of AI companies, including Halo, which is building chips for acceleration of AI. C-True, which is using AI to actually detect automatically what's going through these baggage handling x-rays to save us time when we start flying again. And Texi, who is a spectacular company doing essentially remote service so that you can solve your problems with the internet, TV, or even your washing machine without an employee coming into your home. They do it over your mobile phone. In the agritech area, you're gonna hear shortly from Consumer Physics with the remarkable product, Sio. You're gonna hopefully someday meet our company, Tevo, which is using drones to pick fruit, or CropX, which is building amazing sensors in the ground to measure water and soil quality. In the healthcare area, it's perhaps our strongest area. Companies like Site Diagnostics, which will soon be active in Mexico, where Lip has been very, very helpful. And they have a 10-minute blood test. No more waiting for a day to get your complete blood count. This is an extraordinary breakthrough using artificial intelligence. Zebra Medical using AI to detect automatically radiological images. And companies like Alpha Tau, with their remarkable new anti-cancer treatment, which literally shoots a dart into the cancerous tumor, and in every patient that was tested in clinical trials had efficacy, reduced the tumor, but in 80% of the cases actually destroyed the tumor totally. So with that, I'm going to turn it back to Alan, and it was a pleasure to meet you. I look forward to meeting you here in Israel or meeting you soon in Mexico City shortly. Thank you.
Thank you, John, and thank you for being with us. And lo que yo quiero cubrir ahora muy brevemente es un poquito de darles de color. Perdón, darles un poquito de color sobre la relación estratégica que R-Crowd tiene con LEAP. Realmente es una relación que establecimos a finales del 2018 y ha crecido en forma formidable gracias a la tremenda labor que han hecho Mario, Nathan y Francisco en México. Y bueno, la verdad que no pasa un día en el que alguna de nuestras compañías del portafolio no nos hablan para decir qué increíble es trabajar con LEAP, tenerlos como inversionistas y tenerlos como socios en desarrollo de negocios en el mercado mexicano. Entre las cosas que nosotros en la relación le damos a LEAP y a los clientes de LEAP es acceso al deal flow nuestro, acceso a las compañías que estamos revisando invertir antes de que éstas lleguen al comité de inversión, antes de que éstas lleguen a la plataforma. LEAP tienen visibilidad del pipeline nuestro y pueden en ese momento empezar el due diligence y tomar decisiones de inversión antes de que se acaba, antes de que se agota la alocación de R-Crowd. LEAP tiene acceso a inversiones exclusivas que por razones de la compañía en la que estamos invirtiendo no se nos es permitido ponerlas en la plataforma de R-Crowd. En el caso de que lleguemos a oversubscription, las inversiones de LEAP tienen prioridad sobre inversiones de otros clientes que llegan directamente sobre la plataforma, ya que LEAP se ha convertido en uno de los clientes más importantes de R-Crowd. Por supuesto que facilitamos la conexión entre LEAP y los LPs, los inversionistas que invierten por medio de LEAP en R-Crowd. Cuando estos quieren conectar directamente con las compañías del portafolio nuestro para crear un joint venture, para hacer un negocio, para distribuir el producto, John mencionó la orden más grande que ha recibido Site Diagnostics hasta el día de hoy es de un cliente mexicano que ha invertido con LEAP y que está trayendo las máquinas para hacer los exámenes de sangre a México nuevamente por medio de esta relación. Organizamos Tech Turismo. Son tours para la gente que quiere venir a Israel, y esto probablemente se reanudará en cuanto COVID esté más controlado. Pero antes de COVID teníamos grupos mexicanos asistiendo, visitándonos en Israel y conectando en forma directa con las compañías. Pareciera algo del pasado muy lejano, pero es tan solo hace 6-8 meses y esperamos poder reanudar esta actividad prontamente. Y finalmente, nada más, quiero invitarlos a unirse a nosotros, a unirse a LEAP y R-Crowd, a caminar y a construir y a caminar sobre este puente que conecta el presente con el futuro y que conecta a México con los ecosistemas de Israel y de Estados Unidos, ecosistemas de innovación. Es realmente un placer estar con ustedes acá. Y Mario, te devuelvo el micrófono.
Muchas gracias, John. Muchas gracias, querido Alan. Y obviamente, John y toda la gente de R-Crowd, increíble esta presentación. Y por supuesto, increíble partnership que llevamos a lo largo de este tiempo. Y bueno, para continuar, ahora vamos a ver presentaciones de tres compañías que son parte de nuestro portafolio, son compañías en las que ya estamos invertidos. Entonces, quiero empezar dándole palabra a Gadi Mazdor. Gadi Mazdor es director de operaciones y gerente general de Israel de BioCatch, una compañía de nuestro portafolio. Gadi, thanks very much for joining us, and the floor is yours. Thank you.
Nathan, Mario, thank you very much for inviting me. I didn't know I need to speak in English and in Spanish, but after Alan started in Spanish and John switched to English, I'll feel comfortable switching to Hebrew. Not really. So just I wanted to give a quick presentation on BioCatch. BioCatch is a company that actually our crowd got involved in when I was still working at Our Crowd. I'm one of the founders, and I was GP at Our Crowd when we invested in BioCatch back in 2014. The company made a lot of progress since then, and I want to briefly show you what we do. You all see my screen?
Yes.
I'll take that as a yes. Thank you. So what we do is behavioral biometrics. Every single one of us has a different type of interaction with computers or with devices, the way we hold a device, how much pressure we put when we click the device, the speed in which we type, how we scroll a page. This is unique to us. And all those different signals, 2,000 of those these signals, create a unique fingerprint, if you will, for us when we're interacting with the devices. But instead of kind of going high level, I want to give a few simple examples of how this can be used in specific applications. So I'll start with the simplest, but also the bad news. So the speed that you type, when you pass the age of 40, it goes slower. So we basically lose 2 milliseconds every year of the speed of the click when you type the keyboard. This is measured over billions of sessions and billions of interactions that we have, data that we have. And this can be used as a simple example if, for instance, the bank, and that's primarily our customers, if the bank sees that they know that the account owner is 80 years old, but the interaction in this specific session seems too quick, too fast. It seems like it's a 30 years old person interacting because they type as a 30 year old person, not as 80 year old. That can raise a signal on the bank side that would then either stop or call the owner to make sure that that's indeed them interacting with the account. So that's just one example. Another example is social engineering. So social engineering is now the number one fraud scenario in the world. And that is when someone actually calls someone on the phone, persuading them that they're calling from the bank and something happened in their account and they need to transfer all their money to a new account that was open to them or to some other account. And over the phone, they fooled innocent people from out of their money. And that's in the UK alone, that's £500 million a year stolen primarily from older people by this social engineering. And the challenge is that the actual interaction or with a device and or with the website is actually done by the person being fooled. So someone on the phone is interacting with them, selling them a story, again, social engineering them to send their money, but it's them themselves that do the interaction. But we still see differences in behavior. So for instance, if you're on the phone with someone and they guide you through a transaction, you have more dead time on the session, so time that nothing actually happens between you and the machine. And then many people start to doodle, to move the mouse, as you see on a screenshot. And this is a signal that something weird is going on. We see 300 different minute differences in behavior between a regular session and a session of that user when he's being manipulated, enough to flag the risky transaction and tell the bank, It looks to us that something fishy is going on in the session and you should, again, stop the transaction or call the person and make sure that that nothing fraudulent is going on. Another example is the use of long-term memory. So think about your CURP, I think it's called, the National ID number or the Mexican Social Security number, and think of forms, for instance, that you had to enter those numbers. If it's your own number, you type that from your long-term memory. You type that continuously. You don't hesitate. You never paste that in. It's a number that you know that is built in your brain. If it's not your number, if you stole that number or bought that number and you apply, say, as a fraudster to a credit card on behalf of that user, so stealing their identity, you would type that with many different pauses, typing pauses in that process, and just think what it would take you to type someone else's CURP or social security number. You're going to paste that, or you're going to type that in chunks of three or four letters. The short-term memory is limited to 7 characters, and all those numbers are way longer. Another example from the corporate side, 7%, what we see in our data is 7% of wires are bypassing the existing controls of corporate governance on wire transfers. So the first user needs to authorize, they log in, they authorize the transaction. Then we actually seeing the second authorizer, so logging in with a second authorizer credentials, but it's actually the first human again, with seeing the same behavior. So this is, of course, bypassing all kinds of corporate controls. And this can be just because of laziness of, people just kind of giving each other's credentials so that they can work easier or work faster, or it can be account takeover, internal fraud, and money laundering. So these are just 4 examples of how we use and how we see behavioral biometrics and use that in real-time examples of how we can catch and stop fraud. So the company, as I mentioned, started almost 10 years ago, 9 years ago. Our crowd invested in the company back in 2014. Again, I was back then at our crowd in the investment committee when we invested in the company. We really liked what the company founders started to build, came out of the Elite 8200 unit in the IDF. The company has foundational IP in that space, again, going back 9 years. And looks by now we have 18 billion sessions that we looked at since inceptions, and on a monthly basis, we have over a billion sessions that we look for our customers. We have close to 50 global clients. Some of the largest banks in the world are our clients, and about over 100 million end users that are being protected by our technology. The company, when we invested back again, our crowd invested back then, and the company in the last in the first few years of selling started from the security side. So if you think about the security approaches of basically the 3 kind of legacy approaches, something that you know, this is password, a secret question, etc. Something that you have, so the device and SMS that you receive one-time code, something that you are like fingerprint, face, iris recognition, etc. Those can easily be bypassed, or they are working out completely. So only if you actually put the fingerprint, so you logged into the account, on the mobile app, you put the fingerprint, then there is some certainty that it's you or it's your finger at least, okay? But behavioral, the actual way you interact with the device, that's your innate behavior. It's really pretty much impossible to lose, pretty much impossible to mimic, and this is continuous over the session. So that's what the company started with. This is still the main use cases that the company does. But we look at that wider now, and we basically say that the main thing that the company knows how to do is look at the behavior, the swiping, the holding, the response patterns, the data, the entry attributes, all these interaction elements, again, thousands of those, but actually reverse engineer those to insights. What does that mean on that user? So the examples I gave is low data familiarity, the way you type your social security number. If you type that continuously, you are familiar with the data. So we say that's a user that knows the data, knows the personal data, it's likely the end user. And the duress is what the example that I gave of moving the mouse or different types of patterns of interactions when someone is on the phone with you. So we basically take the behavior that we see and we translate that into insights, and that is being used for different use cases and different in different scenarios. And basically now we sit on as a value of the company. I mean, the data is a major part of what we sit on. We have, again, over 100 million active users per month, over 1.5 billion of transactions a month. Expertise, we work with all the leading or many of the leading financial institutions. You'll see some of the names actually of investors in the company of the major banks. Again, the value is the insights, the ability to reverse engineer that data into behavioral insights, what's actually stands behind what we see in the data, the IP portfolio, and the near implementations, the ability for us to implement and show results from day one and implement relatively quickly and easily with those financial institutions. The company, as I said, started in 2009, so 2011, 9 years ago, made quite a lot of changes last 2.5 years. Again, the tie to our crowd here is that our crowd led the first major investment round back in 2014. We actually put Howard, put Howard Edelstein, who was one of the investors that came to that company through our crowd, we put him on the board. He then became over the years the chairman. And at the end of 2017, the board asked him to actually start being the CEO of the company. And then he asked me to join and manage the Israeli side. And we've done quite a lot of changes over the last 2.5 years. The company raised so far $215 million. The last round was led by Bain Capital. That's not announced yet formally, but this is done that four banks, Barclays, Citi, HSBC, and NAB from Australia, those are all existing customers, and that this is the type of customers that we have, the 50 customers that I mentioned. They also just now, about a week ago, finalized their participation in that in this round. And of course, our crowd and Leap. Leap was part of that, through our crowd, part of that investment round that we just closed. So that's very quick overview of what we do. Mario?
Thank you. Thank you very much, Gadi. As always, an excellent presentation. Thanks very much. And ahora vamos a pasar a Igal Regelgaus. Igal Regelgaus es fundador y CEO de Kartika. Igal, pleasure to have you here. And thanks very much for joining. The stage is yours.
Thank you very much. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Great. So Kartika basically takes a very mature AI technology that is very different than traditional approach to AI that is being used by most of the companies today, and takes this technology to probably the most challenging problem for AI today, which is in the area of autonomous vehicles and automotive and mobility in general. The reason this problem is so challenging is basically because these systems have to run in the car with relatively low compute and to perform, due to the safety reasons, with practically perfect accuracy. We cannot afford any false positive and no false negative as well. The company, as I mentioned, is based on a mature technology, and the reason is that it's a spin-off from Kartika that was working on the technological platform that we call autonomous AI for about a decade. It was a technology that started its development at the Technion. I'm one of the founders. The other three founders come from, one of them is from AI space and neural networks, and the other one is a computational neuroscientist. And essentially what we tried to answer when we developed this technology is why there is such a huge gap between approaches today to AI, such as deep learning, and the way our human brain works when we solve problems such as driving, or even more simple problems like object recognition, navigation, and many others. We use much less energy. Our brain consumes much less energy than cloud computing of Amazon and other platforms, and still we can perform, for example, driving problems very, very accurately. Practically, when we are focused with no mistakes in real time and in a very adaptive manner. So this technology was designed and modeled based on observations coming from Red's brain, that when we talk about problems like recognition, perception, we are very close to other mammals, such as rats or monkeys and so on. And essentially, what we have today is a technology that outperforms any existing AI, specifically in two areas. One is that we don't need labeled data. Every deep learning technology, if you look at companies such as Tesla, Waymo of Google, and Mobileye coming from Israel, they employ thousands and thousands of people that actually label the data, because these deep learning systems that are being used today practically by everyone require the data to be labeled. So they have to mimic the process that first the human do. They cannot learn as we as human do in unsupervised way. So basically just to learn based on exposure to data without any supervision. And that's one of the problems that Kartika succeeded to solve, and has the technology today to basically train AI systems to drive without labeled data. This is, of course, a dramatic change to the industry, and today being leveraged by several major companies that we are working with. The other major advantage of the technology, on top of the first one and the accuracy, is the ability to run at very, very low compute. We are running today based on Renesas chips. It's a Japanese giant that provides auto-graded chips to the automotive industry. And we consume today less than half a watt to perform all the safety features that our competitor Mobileye is performing on a much higher, high computing device called IQ4 that also costs about twice. So that's an additional advantage. This comes from the reason that we as human beings, we don't use our brain, the entire resources of our brain all the time. We are adaptive and we know how to switch and route resources and to use the right elements of our system at the right time. And that's the same principle that we use in Kartika as well. Our system is adaptive and therefore uses different resources based on the contextual information. So if Kartika-enabled car drives on a highway or in a roundabout, different elements, different operators are being used. A few words about the parent company. So the parent company raised over $70 million in investments and more in additional projects and revenues. And the technology is protected today by over 250 patents. In Kartika, we have already 70 additional patents that focus specifically on automotive and mobility use case. Kartika has all the rights to the technology for mobility, automotive, and transportation space. Before launching Kartika, the technology was productized for this use case for over 2 years. And only then we established the company and launched it as independent entity. In this round, our crowd also invested. It was about a year ago. And also our partners, Continental. Continental is one of the leading integrators or tier one companies in the automotive space that have relations with practically every OEM, every car company. They are our strategic partners, both on the commercial side and the investment side. We also have investments from Toyota AI Ventures and BMW Ventures, and also running strategic projects with them. The team of Kartika basically is composed from two disciplines. These are very strong AI people from the relevant units in Israeli army, and also with a lot of experience from academic institutes and from leading companies on the AI front. But we also have a very strong automotive DNA that is a must in order to succeed in this space. We have on our management team, but also as an investor, Carl Thomas Newman, who was the ex-CEO of Continental and also ex-CEO of Opel, is today on the board of Hyundai Mobis and is very key in our processes with the giant companies in the automotive sector. The company today completes with less than a year another round at evaluation that is more than twice of evaluation that our crowd invested about a year ago. And in this round, we have existing investors that will participate and also new investors that we expect to open to the company additional market on top of OEM, also the aftermarket where Mobileye is also quite active. Without going into a lot of details, basically our go-to-market strategy is to use the proven business case that Mobileye created. Mobileye is Israel's largest exit that John mentioned. And basically Mobileye today has a monopoly over ADAS driver assistant market that is based on essentially a single product line. All their products are based on front end camera and a set of safety features that are based on analysis of the information coming through this camera. Since we have a superior technology by far, both in terms of accuracy, cost, power consumption, and also time to market in terms of data that required in order to release such products, we are challenging Mobileye basically within their own strengths or their own game in their market where over 95% of their revenue is created. These are the front-end camera products. Mobileye has generated over $1 billion last year and on track to generate over $2 billion next year with the existing relationship with OEMs. And we are coming with three product lines. The first will be focused on the lower end of the market, basically all the cars that could not afford Mobileye's product because of their high cost and high compute. We are decreasing the cost by 40%, which of course is dramatic, especially in the current situation where these companies are extremely cost sensitive. And the cars must have these products starting 2022 due to regulation. So this basically our first product will be focused on the requirements of the regulation for safety. The second product will introduce a higher end version where it will provide the functionality that is more Tesla-like. So the idea is to enable every car to have a semi-autonomy features, such as Tesla introduced already. And the third one leverages Continental, who is the leading player today on the radar side. And we fuse two signals, camera and radar, to allow a more accurate and a more autonomous product. That's also a very significant advantage point compared to Mobileye that are using only cameras. I mentioned the technology, I will not go in details, but one of the major ideas here, as I mentioned, is unsupervised learning. We are challenging Mobileye from two ends, from the low end, where the price benefits are very clear, and from the high end, where we have a superior functionality. And the key benefits to OEMs are very clear. It's accuracy. They don't need to label data, so it removes the cost of releasing new products. The compute power is about 10 times lower than Mobileye. And we also allow more contextual understanding of scenarios around the car and not just mechanic problems such as object detection. These are the three products. We build them in terms of different tiers, and of course the pricing is accordingly. And we have a very detailed comparison, this technology, and two of the three products are already in a very mature phase. The first one was tested already in over 1 million miles by Continental. Today, Kartika is in the process of extending its relationship from one tier one that basically opens us to the whole ADAS market to three partners. And we expect to close strategic partnerships with these three companies by the end of this year. We also have more long-term projects with the companies such as BMW and Toyota that are also investors in the company, where we introduce a different approach to full autonomy. Similar to the first problem that I introduced, also the full autonomy is heavily based on deep learning, and this requires billions of miles and tagged billions of miles, which makes the problem very, very expensive. These companies like Cruise, Waymo, burning billions of dollars on an annual basis just for the development and for data collection. Our approach allows a set of narrow AI agents, these neural networks that are being selected based on context, and to perform unsupervised learning similar to the way human beings are doing based on clustering, which reduces the need to label so much data. And definitely, once we conquer the mobilized market, we see the full autonomy as the next step. However, the focus of the company today is definitely on the ADAS, where we see that the business is today, and the revenue opportunity is very clear. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Igal. Very insightful presentation, as always. Thanks very much for being here with us. And last but not least, we have Asaf Karmi, who's the CEO of Consumer Physics, and Felipe Ayerbe, who's the co-founder of Demetria. Tenemos finalmente a Asaf Karmi, que es el CEO de Consumer Physics, y tenemos también a Felipe Ayerbe, que es el cofundador de Demetria, que es una de las empresas que está utilizando el producto de Consumer Physics para aplicarlo en mercado latinoamericano, en, bueno, no me voy a adelantar, en algunas cosas interesantes en términos de agricultura, y ahorita seguramente nos lo va a platicar. Adelante. Thank you very much, Asaf and Felipe. The stage is yours.
Thank you, Mario, and thank you, Nathan, for the opportunity to speak. I will share my screen, and I will say that in the meanwhile, I will say that I'm very happy specifically to be here because the relationship between Consumer Physics and LIP is beyond just an investor, but they are actively supporting us and helping us with our penetration into the Latin America market. Consumer Physics vision is to make complex supply chains fully transparent, and we do so by revealing critical information and data in real time. And I know that this is a little high level, and I'm promised to ground it with a specific example in a couple of slides. But before I dive into the slides, I want to talk about the technology we have developed that allows this revealing real-time data. So our technological goal was to develop the best material sensing platform, one that is super simple to use, affordable, and makes the data available. And we started with developing the first in the world cloud-connected microspectrometer. And for those of you who are not familiar with spectrometers, a spectrometer is an optical instrument that is used to analyze the materials for the chemical makeup. Now, a typical spectrometer would be the size of a mini bar or a small refrigerator, and it costs between $20,000 all the way up to $200,000, maybe even $250,000. Our microspectrometer is a chip-sized optical stack, and we used advanced technology that were developed for cell phone camera mostly to make it very robust and accurate, and yet affordable. And the fact that we connected the spectrometer to the cloud enables two important things. The first one, which is obvious, when you're cloud connected, all the data is available all the time to everyone and everywhere, which is important. And the second benefit that we get from being cloud connected is the fact that you are cloud connected gives you access to practically endless computational power. And we use this to develop a set of algorithms that make the spectrometer an easy thing to operate. So for example, if I gave one of you a typical spectrometer, he wouldn't be able to do anything with it. It is a laboratory tool and you need a well-trained technician to operate it and take care of things like sample preparation, sample presentation, calibrating the device. However, if I give any of you one of our spectrometers, most likely that even with zero training, by using a simple and intuitive mobile application, you would be able to start working with it, and the cloud would take care for all the mess that the technician is usually doing with laboratory spectrometer. So the message is that we have developed a technology that allows everyone to analyze material instantly, accurately, and at low cost. And now to explain the what the company is really doing, I'll start with an example, the animal nutrition supply chain. Now, the animal nutrition supply chain, and when you think of it for the first time, it could be surprising to see how complex the supply chain is. And this, by the way, would be true for many other supply chains. At the end, yes, there is a farmer who feeds animals, but it starts with the seed companies that invest tremendous efforts and resources to develop and produce the best seeds. There are the growers, those that aggregate the crops, the feed processors, and the nutritionists, and there are a lot of players in this supply chain. Now, there are two problems with this supply chain. First, or I would start by saying that naturally, each of the many players in this supply chain needs to optimize their processes or tries to optimize its process. And to do that, they must be able to analyze materials. So for example, if you grow corn and you want to optimize your corn quality, you need to be able to analyze corn. If you pay premium for high protein wheat or soybean, you should be able to analyze protein in soybean and wheat. And if you want to deliver the best feed to your animals, well, I think that you get the idea. You need to be able to actually analyze for quality your feed. But there are problems. And there are two different ways to look at these problems. First, it is very difficult to analyze material outside the lab. And hence, data is missing. And critical data is missing. And the other way to look at it is that because you don't have enough data and the data does not flow across the supply chain, critical decisions are not made properly. There are a lot of suboptimal decisions. For example, you don't sell your crop at the right price because you don't know what it's the quality of your crops. So what do we do to solve this problem? So what we do is that we take different players in the supply chain and we provide those players the best solution for their material analysis needs, the best solution that they can get. So for example, here we have a corn seed grower. For a corn seed grower, moisture is a critical parameter to track. He needs this parameter to smartly manage in time the desiccation and harvest. He needs it to predict yield. This is critical for the seed grower. Now, there are a lot of problems with the existing solution. First and foremost, in many cases, the data needs to come from remote laboratory, and it takes a lot of time and a lot of money. The in-the-field methods that a farm or grower can use are cumbersome and require cutting and shedding the corn, which is a mess and takes a lot of time and also cost for the grower. So what we have provided for the growers is a method, and this is the only method to do that, to accurately measure the corn moisture while it's still on the cob. So the grower just walk in the field, take our device, which is a pocket-sized device, scan the corn, continues. And also it covers all the moisture levels that that the grower needs, instant results. So we provided the corn seed grower the best material analysis solution that he can get. Now, the nice thing, and this is important, is that the grower's data is very interesting, not just for the grower, but for others as well. It is very valuable for others. So for example, for by tracking moisture in the corn field, you can predict much more accurately the overall yield and make much smarter decisions on your trading. And you have other examples here, but I won't dive into those. But the idea is that you get data from one player in the chain, but this data is important not just for this specific player. And this is what we do. We simply provide many players in the supply chain the best solution they can get. Each or every one of them may get a different solution, but they all get the best solution that they can get, or at least many of them. And then we make the entire supply chain more effective, as this data, which is valuable, not for those, just for those who extract this data, this is valuable for all the supply chain, and this becomes available. Now, this was not just an example. This is actually already happening for the animal nutrition supply chain. We have over 1,500 users, seed companies, growers, traders, livestock farmers, many different types of players in this value chain with almost million data points now. And we provide to our customers dashboard analytics and all kinds of global or capabilities to take a global view and improve their processes. And maybe I should read one of the, and this is something that he sent us a couple of months ago, a person from a mid-sized seed company from the Midwest, that this is the way he sees the solution we provide him. So cell device has triggered a domino effect in our entire process, more testing, requiring fewer people with more accurate data, meant we began making faster and smarter decisions that led to more accurate spring and harvest schedules, less waste, and ultimately better product. At the end of the day, each of these key factors improves our bottom line. So this is already happening with the animal nutrition, but we actually, there are many more supply chains that are relevant. One of them that you will hear just following this presentation is the coffee, but there are many others. And we are today have customers that are not only on the animal nutrition and in corn and grain, but also some that are actually not in the agriculture sector. Now, we started with the agriculture. We started with the agriculture mostly because of a very good fit that there is between our technology and the agriculture needs. The fact that you need something that is distributed and that the supply chains are very complex. We started specifically with the mass crops, with corn, soybean, wheat, animal feed, and we're expanding to other crops in within the agriculture sector, in some cases within partners. Well, and this, again, you will hear about one example within minutes. And ultimately, we have, of course, many other potential markets. This is how the company grows. So in the short term, we deliver solutions mostly for corn, soybean, wheat, and animal nutrition, and we are expanding. One important step that we did this year is that we expanded in Latin America. In 2019, we operated mostly in North America, and this year we already have hundreds of users in Latin America as well. And this is one thing that we are working on these days. And we are expanding to more crops, some by ourselves, some with partners. And another very interesting step that we are doing, which is going to increase significantly the serviceable market, is to integrate our technology into farm facilities and machinery integrations. One of the things that we are already working on is combine integration. Just imagine the effect that if you have a combine that when it harvests the soybean, it measures continuously the quality of the soybean for oil content and protein content as accurately as a laboratory measurement. And imagine the effect that this is going to have on the high protein soybean market, which is becoming more and more important these days. And last but not least, at some point in the future, of course, we are going to expand beyond agriculture. We actually have a few customers that are not in the agriculture market, but still this is something that is not in our immediate focus, but definitely the company would go after it since our solution is relevant on everywhere or for every supply chain that suffer from the same problem, that every piece of this supply chain needs a different solution, but the fact that you solve those problems bring additional value by connecting all the dots and make the supply chain transparent and makes it not just a chain, but a continuous flow of data. So thank you, Mario.
Thanks very much, Asaf. Always really enlightening. Thank you very much. And we have tenemos a Felipe Ayerbe para terminar unos minutitos más. Felipe. Sí, te alcanzamos a ver, pero no te escuchamos.
Perdón. Buenas tardes a todos. Me vuelvo a pasar a español, que creo que es la preferencia para todos. Entonces, denme un segundo para ver si... ¿Están viendo mi pantalla?
Sí.
Perfecto. Muchas gracias. Entonces, lo que les vengo a contar es un poco, digamos, un sabor muy parecido a lo que hace LEAP al final del día, porque, digamos, coincidencialmente nosotros también somos inversionistas en Consumer Physics. Y básicamente nosotros nos encontramos con la oportunidad de implementar la tecnología Consumer Physics en una serie de digamos, cadenas de valor en donde claramente hay una avidez por tecnología y existe un retraso. Y esas son las cadenas de valor de lo que nosotros llamamos agricultura tropical. Entonces, lo que les voy a contar es más bien, sobre todo, la aplicación de la tecnología de Consumer Physics al café. Pero básicamente lo que quería empezar por decirles es un poco un concepto que es importantísimo, y es que en las cadenas de valor de sobre todo la agricultura, digamos que a la cual estamos expuesta en Latinoamérica y lo que nosotros llamamos agricultura tropical, no hay datos. No hay ningún dato. Y esto es algo muy importante porque ustedes ya lo han oído recurrentemente, y es que y esto es, digamos, aquí incluí una cita de The Economist, que es evidentemente un medio muy respetado, que el nuevo petróleo es la data. Ahora, a diferencia del petróleo, que es valioso porque tiene un valor de escasez, o sea, hay poco, entonces por lo tanto vale mucho, la data es más valiosa entre más haya. Entonces, esto es muy importante porque lo que nosotros hemos encontrado, gracias al acceso a la tecnología, digamos, que produce Israel, es que hay una oportunidad billonaria en llevar esta tecnología para atacar dos problemas que son muy importantes en las cadenas de valor agroalimentarias, que son calidad y trazabilidad. Les voy a contar un poco qué es lo que hace Demetria. Entonces, nosotros lo que hacemos es que nos concentramos en agricultura tropical, en commodities de relativo alto valor, y lo que hacemos es, a través de la cadena de valor, muy parecido a lo que les acaba de contar Asaf en Consumer Physics, usamos tecnología que no es solo la de Consumer Physics, usamos otras tecnologías, pero arrancamos principalmente con la tecnología de Consumer Physics para atacar esos dos problemas, calidad y trazabilidad, que son problemas cada vez más relevantes. Sobre todo, teniendo en cuenta que si ustedes ya están algo familiarizados con el mundo de AgTech, es que ha habido mucho enfoque hacia el tema de productividad. ¿Cómo produzco más con menos, con la información, digamos, que me da la inteligencia artificial, etcétera, etcétera? Que es algo que, digamos, que es una palanca muy importante. Y lo que nosotros entendemos es que la palanca de calidad es una palanca de valor que también es sumamente generosa en generación de valor. En el caso de café, y me imagino que algunos de ustedes conocen algo, la diferencia entre un café promedio, o sea, un café commodity de calidad promedio, y un café extraordinario, un café especial, puede ser de 3 o 4 veces el precio. Entonces, digamos, si nosotros podemos activar esa palanca con tecnología, capturamos una parte de ese valor. Y eso es lo que estamos tratando de hacer. Entonces, les cuento un poco cuál es la oportunidad. Entonces, la situación de la agricultura tropical es una situación en donde tenemos, en algunos casos, inclusive son prácticas del siglo XIX o inclusive siglos anteriores. Tienen muy poco acceso a equipos de control de calidad. Como decía Saf, por ejemplo, en el caso de los espectrómetros, un espectrómetro de nivel de entrada, hoy en día, de laboratorio, cuesta lo más barato $20,000. Entonces, pues digamos, para un pequeño campesino, eso es inasequible. Entonces, no es práctico. Tienen cadenas de valor extremadamente fragmentadas. O sea, y en cada punto de esa cadena, pues existe una fricción de precio-calidad. Entonces, existe mucha oportunidad para poder, digamos, atacar esos problemas de transparencia. Lo que les decía, la calidad es una gigantesca palanca de valor. O sea, en algunos casos puede ser 2, 3, 4 veces el incremento en precio. Y cada vez más, el tema de trazabilidad, los consumidores, y esto lo hemos visto, digamos, exacerbado por la pandemia, los consumidores quieren tener una conexión con lo que se están metiendo en las bocas, digamos, lo que están metiendo a sus cuerpos. Entonces, el tema de trazabilidad, de efectivamente entender de dónde vino, cómo se manejó, qué pasó, es cada vez más relevante. Entonces, por eso es que nosotros vemos una oportunidad gigantesca en usar este tipo de tecnología para lograr mayor transparencia en la cadena de valor y poder empezar a medir calidad. Aquí la máxima que nos enseñaron a todos en la escuela de negocios es lo que no se mide no se gerencia. Y eso pasa en calidad increíblemente en uno de los commodities más grandes. Y lo otro es que vamos a usar esos datos para completamente generar una irrupción en la cadena de valor. Porque, de nuevo, vamos a pasar algo que no se medía a que se mida y a habilitar control de calidad en vez de que fuera ex post a que sea ex ante, casi que en el proceso. Como decía Saf ahorita, imagínense que uno de estos sensores está en la máquina cosechadora que ya está midiendo. Entonces, puedes tomar decisiones muy temprano en la cadena de valor antes de que sean más costosas en el proceso. Entonces, eso es un poco, digamos, la oportunidad. Les prometo que ahora ya les concreto exactamente qué es lo que estamos haciendo. No me voy a gastar mucho en esto porque pues ya Asaf les contó cómo funciona la tecnología. Estamos usando exactamente los equipos que tiene Asaf y su infraestructura. Entonces, esto también es una gran ventaja porque lo que nosotros hicimos fue agarrar una tecnología probada y la adaptamos a una situación de los mercados emergentes. Entonces, eso nos permitió en un tiempo relativamente corto de tiempo desarrollar una serie de aplicaciones que ya les cuento por qué creemos que son disruptivas. Entonces, les voy a contar un poco el caso para café y por qué creemos que es disruptivo. Es increíble, pero yo no sé si ustedes saben, en café la única manera de determinar la calidad del café es hacer lo que están haciendo estos señores en esta foto, que es hacer una catación de café. Existe una profesión que se llama ser catador de café certificado. Entonces, en cada punto de la cadena, que es bien fragmentada, la única forma es, tienen que agarrar un café que está, digamos, en lo que nosotros conocemos como café verde, tienen que tostarlo, preparar una taza y hacer todo un protocolo, digamos, para hacer una catación, y tienen que ser personas, pues, altamente calificadas. Es altamente, digamos, alto consumo de tiempo, o sea, un proceso de catación puede demorar 40 a una hora. Es bastante costoso, porque evidentemente no hay catadores en todos los puntos de compra, no todos los productores tienen acceso a un catador, es muy complejo, y no hay datos. No hay visibilidad de datos a través de la cadena de valor. Es increíble, digamos, siendo el café, digamos, uno de los commodities más transados a nivel global, que no haya ningún tipo de dato de calidad. Y es increíble, entonces, por ejemplo, para un tostador, entonces les doy un ejemplo que quizá conozcan, Nespresso, para que ellos sepan exactamente qué calidad está disponible, tienen que esperar que el café pase de los productores, llega a las cooperativas, y cuando ya están en los exportadores que han podido catar el café, ya saben qué tipo de disponibilidad hay de suministro para ver qué le van a vender a los consumidores. Eso es exacerbado por un problema, y es que los productores de café, y esto es en todo el mundo, el promedio son muy pequeños. O sea, el promedio de tamaño de una finca cafetera es de 2 a 4 hectáreas. Entonces, si ustedes suman millones de productores, una cadena altamente fragmentada es una oportunidad que casi que lo hace uno salivar de la oportunidad de hacer un impacto muy grande. Entonces, ¿qué hicimos? Nosotros hicimos una serie de aplicaciones y estamos desarrollando algunas, otras que ya están funcionando con la tecnología Consumer Physics, que lo que hacemos es que agarramos el sensor de Consumer Physics y lo entrenamos con la información de los catadores para hacer el trabajo de los catadores. Entonces, lo que antes solo se podía hacer en un laboratorio de catación por alguien súper costoso, que no podía viajar, que no podía hacerlo en el campo, hoy en día lo podemos hacer en cualquier lugar. Entonces, les voy a contar unos pocos casos de estudio que les da un sabor más concreto de cómo es el impacto y qué estamos haciendo. Entonces, aquí este es un cliente con el que estamos trabajando aquí en Colombia. Es un gran exportador de café. Entonces, ¿qué le pasa a este gran exportador? Su problema era que ellos tenían un perfil de sabor de café muy importante, de muy alto valor, que de hecho hoy en día sabemos que su cliente es Nespresso, que busca ese perfil. Entonces, Nespresso usa ese perfil de sabor para algunos de sus pods. Entonces, para que los consumidores como nosotros puedan tener siempre la misma experiencia, ellos tienen que buscar que siempre ese café venga con ese perfil de sabor. Entonces, hoy en día la única manera como lo podían encontrar era, tiene que salir a visitar. En Colombia estamos hablando que son del orden de 40,000 productores que están dentro de la red de Nespresso, ir a visitar las fincas, ir a conocer el café, llevarlo a los centros de catación, entender si podía ser el perfil o no. Y de todos modos ese proceso se perdía porque cada cosecha del café es distinto. Con el café pasa lo mismo que con el vino, que lo influencia todo lo que se llama el terroir. Entonces es un sistema altamente complejo y costoso para identificar y prospectar ese tipo de café. ¿Qué hicimos nosotros? Desarrollamos una aplicación que entrenamos al sensor de Consumer Physics junto con la inteligencia artificial, con la información de los catadores, y hoy en día tenemos una aplicación que tanto los puntos de compra como los, inclusive los campesinos en el campo, pueden directamente identificar sobre un batch de café verde si es o no el perfil sensorial que están buscando. Esto es una revolución, porque es, con este sensor nosotros podemos saber a qué sabe el café sin probarlo. Entonces, esto cambia, digamos, el paradigma de cómo se compra el café, porque inicialmente, como les digo, la idea es que lo tengan los compradores de café, pero eventualmente, en la medida que lo tienen los mismos productores, en la nube yo le puedo decir a Carcafé o a Nespresso, mira, en esta vereda, en este sitio, acaba de alguien medir café que tiene exactamente el perfil que tú estás buscando. Entonces, en esencia, un poco lo que nos queremos volver es un poco el Google del café. O sea, que nosotros vamos a tener acceso a una data de calidad que antes era inaccesible.
Felipe, la verdad, increíblemente interesante. Tenemos que ir cerrando por tiempos.
Listo. Entonces, un último caso por tiempo, que es un caso distinto, y el caso que estamos trabajando con la Federación de Cafeteros, y es, aquí es un caso un poco distinto en el sentido de que, y un poco haciendo eco a algo de lo que dijeron Mario y Natán al principio, y es, no solo estamos en este negocio para hacer dinero, sino también para generar un impacto social. Una de las cosas que es muy importante es, hoy en día en Colombia, dado que los primeros puntos de compra no tienen la capacidad de catar o probar todo el café que les llega, a los campesinos se les paga por el mínimo común denominador. O sea, se asume que el café que se le vende es de baja calidad. Y obviamente los intermediarios son los que se ganan el premio. Entonces, el caso que estamos haciendo con la Federación de Cafeteros, estamos desarrollando una aplicación de calidad que le permita en el punto de compra decirle al cafetero su café es calidad A, B o C y pagarle de acuerdo a calidad. Esto es una revolución. En Colombia solo hay 500,000 cafeteros. En el mundo hay 6 millones de cafeteros. Entonces, este tipo de aplicación, que es llevar la tecnología y darle el acceso democrático a esa tecnología y balancear la escala de poder entre comprador y vendedor, es una de las cosas que nos motiva. Entonces, yo creo que con esto se dieron una buena idea de un enlace entre la tecnología israelí y el caso de negocio de lo que podemos aplicar, digamos, en nuestros países para generar, como lo introdujeron Mari y Natán, hacer el salto de rana a generar un impacto muy importante. Entonces, yo creo que con esto cierro. Muchas gracias por el espacio.
Al contrario, Felipe, la verdad es que muchas gracias a ti. La verdad, increíble, impactante todo lo que se está desarrollando con este tema y con lo que está desarrollando con el tema del café. Y bueno, ya básicamente para terminar, antes que nada lo voy a decir en inglés. Thanks everyone, all the speakers for your tremendous talks, very insightful, very interesting. Like to thank you very much. Y a todos los participantes también les queremos agradecer. Por supuesto, muchas gracias a todos nuestros ponentes. Y para cerrar este webinar, los queremos dejar con esta pequeña reflexión. Cuando comienza la crisis, el error más común que cometemos es congelarnos pensando, esta cosa mala no me puede estar pasando a mí. Y nos quedamos en este estado hasta adaptarnos. Este congelamiento resulta en tiempo valioso perdido. El segundo error es gastar demasiada energía intentando controlar una situación que fundamentalmente es incontrolable. Esta es una forma ineficiente y poco productiva del uso del tiempo y la energía. La clave para sobrevivir e incluso triunfar es enfocarse en aceptar que el mundo cambió, entender qué cambió y por qué, y adaptarse hacia la nueva dirección del mundo. Y la gran pregunta es, ¿en qué te estás enfocando hoy? Eso sí está en tu control.
Y por ello, los invitamos a que abracemos la incertidumbre, este cambio tan acelerado que está ocurriendo, y no nada más que nos acostumbremos a ella, sino que aprendamos a quererla. Seamos los líderes que necesita la humanidad hacia el futuro para transformar de manera positiva nuestro mundo. Soñemos muy, muy en grande. Todos estos proyectos nacen de una idea definitivamente ejecutada con mucha brillantez, pero de una idea y de un sueño. Y atrevámonos a transformar nuestra realidad. Estos son algunos ejemplos, pero definitivamente nosotros como individuos estamos empoderados para hacer lo mismo y transformar nuestra realidad de manera muy positiva.
Gracias nuevamente por su participación. Terminando el evento, les vamos a enviar una breve encuesta. Agradeceremos la respuesta y les recordamos que el webinar está grabado por si alguien quiere consultarlo posteriormente. Dejamos nuestros datos de contacto en pantalla y los invitamos a que seamos parte. Muchas gracias y buenas tardes.